So this morning we reviewed the situation in the newspaper industry and the difficulties the industry seems to be facing, and looked at some thoughts on what might be possible solutions to those difficulties. And then in the second session, we reviewed a couple of attempts that have been made in Spain and Germany to provide some kind of copyright-based solution to those problems, and analyzed the difficulties and the problems that those particular attempts had encountered. We're now, this afternoon, turning to the European proposals and the European interest in this zone. So moving away from national law. And last December, the Commission issued a communication towards a modern, more European copyright framework. And in that communication, it hinted at the possibility of some work that would be done, perhaps some initiative taken in relation to news aggregators. So the Commission noted that member states had attempted to find solutions and that these solutions that member states were proposing carried the risk of more fragmentation in the digital single market, so that the European Commission might regard it as necessary to consider whether any actions specific to news aggregators is needed. So at that point, any intervention that seemed to be going to occur was targeted specifically at news aggregators and was intended to benefit newspaper press publishers. In March, rather out of the blue, I thought, on the 23rd of March, the Commission issued an additional consultation on neighboring rights that was examining the role of publishers in the value chain and defined publishers as the publishers of press and other print products. And the consultation proposed the possibility of a new neighboring right for these publishers. It gave us no detail at all as to what that neighboring right would look like, and no detail really on quite what it was hoped that it would achieve. The consultation comprises a series of questions about how the absence of such a right affects licensing and enforcement by press and other publishers, and the potential impact of a new neighboring right, the nature of which we know nothing, on authors, press publishers, intermediaries, and so forth. And it asked these questions. We're supposed to tell what the impact would be without knowing what on earth the right might itself be. And it asks, finally, whether there's been any impact from solutions in member states producing new so-called ancillary rights. So that's where we are. We're in a space where we're being asked to respond about a proposal that we can't really know about. The publishers themselves have issued some documentation that helps fill out, I think, some of the things that they want, but without giving much clarity to what it is that's in the Commission's mind. So faced with this really unknowable, unknown proposition, we decided to ask a number of speakers to speculate about the benefits and problems that might arise from introducing such a neighbouring right. And the first session this afternoon relates to the possible economic effects, to the question of the relationship between the new neighbouring right and other intellectual property rights regimes that we already have, and to the place of this right in the political process. In the final session, we'll look at how this impacts on consumers, on new entrants to the market, particularly new news aggregators and new businesses of that sort, free speech, and also the relationship with broader themes of technology and democracy. So for the first session, we have three speakers. Firstly, to your left, Bertin Martens, who is an economist. He did a PhD in economics at the Free University of Brussels, and he now works for the European Commission's Institute for Prospective Technological Studies in Seville in Spain. But having said that that's where he works, he will be speaking on this topic in a personal capacity. He's not representing in any way the Commission. After Bertin, we will hear from Bernt Hugenholtz. You've already seen him as a chair asking difficult and probing questions of various speakers. He is a professor of information law at the University of Amsterdam and needs really no further introduction to this audience. And then finally, we'll have Marietje Schaake, and I do apologize. I just can't get my... I've been in the Netherlands now for a little while, and it's not getting any better for the Dutch having me here to listen to my horrible pronunciation of these words. So I apologize. Marietje is an MEP in the Dutch Democratic Party, which is part of the ALDE group. She works on neighborhood policy, on trade and technology, and she was involved in the European Parliament's dealings with the TTIP. But she is also the founder of, or a founder member of, the Digital Agenda Intergroup, which includes, amongst others, Julia Rader, well-known figure in the copyright world. So, Bertin.
Thank you, Lionel. As Lionel said, I'm an economist, and I work in one of the joint research centers of the European Commission. I don't work in the policy group, so whatever I say should not be interpreted as necessarily reflecting the thinking that's going on in Brussels on the policy side and the policy-making side regarding these neighboring rights. I'm an economist, and my job is to look at the empirical evidence regarding potential impact of such rights. So, and that's what I'm looking into. First, let me start with a few comments, first of all. It is clear, I think, that the newspaper industry is under enormous financial pressure over the last couple of years, and some for many years already. And they are losing subscription revenue from print and trying to compensate that through digital and experimenting with paywalls on their websites, some more successful than others. Trying to get ad revenue. They lost ad revenue in print versions, and they're now trying to compensate that at least to some extent, and in most cases to only a small extent, with digital ad revenue. And so I understand their position, that they're trying to find all kinds of possible ways to increase their revenue. If I were in that industry, I would certainly do the same thing. I'm not so sure, though, whether the news aggregators or their main enemy or the main competitive pressure on their business models. I think there are many other sources of pressure on the industry. For one thing, I think there are many more sources of news nowadays than there used to be before the internet age. You have bloggers, you have all kinds of people who produce news on Twitter, on Facebook, on so many places on the internet, that if you want to read news, you can find it anywhere for free, basically. And so the newspaper business model is under a lot of pressure, and I have a lot of understanding for that. At the same time, I think we should look at the wider picture rather than just a news aggregator case. This morning we had a lot of talk about, obviously, Google News as an aggregator, and you could also talk about Yahoo News. That's far less important here in Europe, but more important in the US. Apple News is now coming up. And we should not forget new kids on the block, new big kids on the block, like Facebook, who are rapidly making inroads in the newspaper industry, with fairly different approaches, I think, compared to Google News. And I think it will be more difficult for the newspaper industry in the future to resist the offers from Facebook than it is to resist the offers from, or the lack of offers from Google News. Secondly, another comment is that I think somebody this morning in the second session used the word ripping when he referred to the fact that 100 years ago, a journalist from Mr. Hearst's group used to walk to the Associated Press windows, look what the latest news was there, run back to the office and write down an article and then onwards with it. Ripping nowadays is a universal phenomenon in the newspaper industry. Somebody did a study last year on the French newspaper industry, Julia Cage and some of her researchers from Paris Télécom, and they monitored a number of newspaper websites, 50 or 60 newspapers in France for a period of time. And what they found is that as soon as a new event, news item appears on one newspaper's website, within half an hour, 40 minutes, it appears on all everybody else's website, which means that they are just monitoring each other. And as soon as something news appears, they take that news event, rewrite it a little bit, and then post it on their own website. So ripping in that sense has become a universal phenomenon in the newspaper industry, not because of the aggregators, but in the industry itself. A third comment I wanted to make is that we spoke a lot about the Spanish and the German case this morning. But maybe we should also have a look at the Belgian case and the French case, where the newspaper industry came to some sort of an agreement with Google News. Maybe not entirely to their satisfaction, but at least it generated some revenue and some arrangements that were thought to be beneficial, short of a full license agreement. And so the negotiated approach may offer some inroads. Another comment that I wanted to make is that I'm over the last couple of months very much involved in looking at media platforms, and I think somebody also mentioned the word platforms and the economics of platforms here. It's indeed very hard to beat platforms, and especially large platforms, when it comes to the revenue and the attraction that they offer. And so there is the risk, and we've seen that in many industries, not only in newspapers, is that content providers, the ones who actually publish or produce the content, whether it's digital services, media services, or even goods, they become a sort of almost a subcontractor to the platform. And the platform has a lot of leverage on the prices and on the margins they extract from it. We see that in the hotel business. We see that in airline bookings. We see that in so many industries. And the same is happening to the newspaper industry. And so resisting that pressure from the platforms is a very hard thing to do. And I understand that the newspapers want to get a fairer share of the advertising revenue that the platforms get from this business. But as an economist, and I think for most of economists, the word fairness, or the lack of it, unfairness, is a concept we have a hard time to deal with. We know competition and the lack of competition in the market, and we have some criteria to deal with that. But unfairness, is 10% of the share, is that fair or unfair? The German newspaper publishers want to get 6%, and even that is a hard struggle. Is that a fair share or not? We don't know. As an economist, I leave that to the politicians and to sociologists or whoever, but I cannot answer that question. So this brings me to a more economic approach to this newspaper business and news aggregation. And there is some empirical evidence already. There are by now, as far as I know, 5-6 studies, empirical studies that deal with this, that look into this. Some were already mentioned here this morning. Indeed, for Spain, we have a study done by Nesta, a UK consultancy company, at the request of some Spanish newspaper publishers who were unhappy with the change in the copyright regime that led to the closing down of Google News in Spain, and because they saw that it diminished the traffic to their website, and so diminishes their ad revenue. And indeed, the Nesta study confirmed that, and that it had a negative impact on their ad revenue. What the study also showed is that indeed users, rather than going through the Google News aggregator that did no longer operate in Spain, went back to the old search engine, Google Search, and that way found their newspaper articles. But for me as an economist, this is possibly the worst of all possible solutions, in the sense that the newspapers lose in terms of traffic and ad revenue, and consumers lose, because it sets them back 5 years in time in access to internet-based services. 5 years on the internet is like a century in the offline world. So instead of having everything on your app, on your mobile phone, you have to go back to search, and search on your mobile phone is a tedious business, so you only do that on your iPad or on your laptop. So a lot of transaction costs for so consumers lose and producers lose. So nobody, it's a lose-lose situation rather than a win-win situation. In that sense, the German solution is not that bad, in the sense that Google still operates their Google News aggregator, and so the situation, despite the law, the current situation is still the same as it was before the law. So what we know from this empirical evidence is that the impact of dropping Google News aggregation is actually negative for newspapers. And so that leaves a puzzling question for an economist. Why would newspapers want to do this, or have this change in the law, or have this neighboring right, when it doesn't bring them any benefits? What do they expect from it? Now, what they expect, of course, is a larger share, a fairer share of the revenue, the ad revenue. Whether they're going to get that through this means, I don't know. We'll have to see what court cases, in, amongst others in Germany, are going to say in the next couple of years on this. So this brings me to a second aspect that is important from an economic point of view, is that we do not only look as economists at the revenue side of copyright, the revenue for the owners of rights, for the publishers of newspapers in this case. We also look at the consumer side, and we try to strike a balance between those two and see who gains, who loses, and how much. And so I'm a public policy economist, and I look at the impact on society as a whole, not only on one group of stakeholders in society. And then we see that with this increase in transaction costs for consumers, the consumers lose out on this. So how much is this worth in terms of consumer welfare compared to how much is this worth in terms of producer welfare, additional revenue? So far, we have not seen any additional revenue for newspaper producers, but there's a loss for consumers. So another aspect of this is that we should look at the innovation side of this. Again, we talked a lot about Google News, one of the giants in this market, but we forget often that there are dozens of other smaller news aggregators in that market. And in the case of Spain, for instance, several of those had to shut down as well. And these were small startup businesses, and they simply disappeared from the market because the legal situation did not allow them to continue. So there's a lot of innovation that's being struck down through this approach. And then we have to think about what do we want to do from a European digital single market perspective? Do we want to promote innovation, or do we want to protect existing business models? So what is the balance between those two? How can we deal with this? It's a very difficult question to answer, I think. The question is, what is the question? And I've been wondering this whole morning listening to the first two sessions. So what is the problem that we are trying to solve? Clearly, for newspapers, there's a problem. There's diminishing revenue. Whether that could be solved through an extension of these neighboring rights, so far the empirical evidence doesn't seem to point in that direction. I try to be very diplomatic on this. Maybe there are other examples where there is evidence, but so far we haven't seen any of that evidence. the problem from a consumer side is that these news aggregators give them lots of benefits in terms of an easy transaction cost, low transaction cost based approach. And if that cannot come through, then yeah, there's a problem for consumers as well. Can we address this by other means than copyright? And can we address this through a platform approach? I think some of the cues that we get out of the French newspapers and the Belgian newspapers' idea to work through the search, Google search function, rather than the news aggregation function, offers some scope for other ways of solving this, coming to an agreement with the Google search function and that way getting back into the news aggregator. Because obviously, newspapers, especially big national newspapers, rank very high in the search engine ranking in a particular country. And so Google would probably be very sensitive to losing that traffic because it's an important part of their traffic in that country. Of course, consumers for newspaper reading are rapidly moving to mobile reading on their mobile phones, and then these apps and the aggregator become a key entry gate. But there may be a few years left for newspapers to try to work their way back into this through the search engine gate rather than through the news aggregator gate. But time is short for that because consumers are rapidly shifting ways. And we've already seen there are some statistics for the US, I think, that show that more than 60% of newspaper reading actually now happens on mobile phones. Compared to 4 years ago, where this was less than 20%. So it's very rapidly moving. And I think in Europe, maybe we have a 1 or 2 years delay compared to that, but we were also moving in that direction. What we don't have empirical evidence on, and this I think is a big gap in our knowledge, is a wider view on what the impact of search of news aggregators or the lack of news aggregators would be on overall societal welfare in terms not only of news producer revenue, but also consumer welfare. Some people have started working, some researchers have started working in this direction, but there's not really enough empirical evidence for that. In order to do this sort of work properly, we would have to work with some of these big news aggregators because they have the data to do this. But these are privately held data by these companies, and we as researchers have no access to that. There was some work done by Microsoft in 2012 on these news aggregation sites in France again that shows that the impacts of news aggregators varies by type of newspaper. And I think this is also an important message that we should take into account. And again, a message that we've seen in many other media industries. What happens is that, let's say, the middle of the road provincial or national newspaper that produces a bit of everything but is not very specialized in anything can lose out from these aggregators. But the more high-end newspapers, the quality newspapers, or the more long-tail newspapers that specialize in a particular topic and people who really want to read that newspaper because they're interested in that topic, they don't lose out, they gain a lot of traffic from these news aggregators. So it depends as a newspaper on where you are in that spectrum. And we've seen this superstar economics versus long-tail economics in many other media industries all over the internet, where we see that the search engines put a lot of pressure on the middle ground, but increase the superstar effect and increase the long tail effect. So for newspapers, also probably a question of positioning. One final comment, if I may, that I would like to make is a lot of the debate this morning implicitly or explicitly referred to the questions of how come we got that far? How come the newspaper industry is under such a lot of pressure? Again, as an economist, and looking at the evidence, the empirical evidence, what we see is that there's an enormous increase in the supply of news. I already referred to that briefly. That you can read newspaper articles anywhere on the internet for see basically about current events. But if you want a more specialized or more background or more deeply researched articles, of course, that becomes more difficult. And then you go to more specialized sites. But even for this specialized news, thousands, millions of bloggers in the world, thousands of millions of Facebook accounts offer you such a rich insight. But it's, of course, uncurated. And a lot of the function of these news aggregators is curation. And many news aggregators not only go to newspapers, but also to blog posts, for instance. And personally, I find in the areas where I'm interested in, looking at specialized aggregation engines that follow the subjects that I do, a lot of the news events come out of these blog posts and out of Facebook accounts. And there's simply an enormous increase of supply, an increase in the production of news. And if supply increases and demand remains constant, the price goes down. So the value of a news article actually goes down. And people are willing to pay less for it because there's such an oversupply of it. And we've seen that again in many media industries. We've seen that in music, for instance, where you get Spotify nowadays and you get an offer of 45 million songs, basically all the music in the world you could possibly think of, for €6 or €7 a month. And so, and for every spin, every stream of that song, the music producer gets paid at 1/100 or 1/1000th of a euro cent. And so, yeah, they complain, it's very little money, but you get streamed millions of times and maybe you can still make some living out of that. And the same, I think, is the destination for news industries. How to make a business model out of that, how to build a business model around that in the long run, I don't know the answer, but there's certainly going to be a lot of experimenting around this, as we have seen in other industries. The music industry has been struggling for 10 years. Now they seem to sort of get around to that, with a few streaming sites that dominate the business increasingly, but that somehow make it livable. Whether the same destiny is waiting for the newspaper industry, I would not know. But we've seen that in many online industries. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Ask any reasonably intelligent copyright expert, and we're all at least reasonably intelligent, why news is not copyright subject matter, and the answer will probably be because there is no copyright in ideas, facts, and other bits of information. This is sort of rule number one on copyright. We learn it at the very first day we do a lecture on copyright. It's the idea-expression dichotomy. Those are complex words to express this very simple notion. It's a rule that we don't see in our national laws usually, although it is in the United States, Copyright Act. But we do see it increasingly in international agreements. It's in TRIPS. It's in the WIPO Copyright Treaty. And it's also, but in a different form, in the Berne Convention already, that very old original International Copyright Convention. Article 2.8 says the following: the protection of this convention shall not apply to news of the day or to miscellaneous facts having the character of mere items of press information. That's a reflection of this idea that copyright should not attach to facts. It's actually a little bit more than that. The fact that it mentions shall is an instruction to the convention states not to grant such protection. And in that respect, it is comparable to the quotation right on which our chairman, Lionel Bently, is writing a very interesting 100-page paper that will soon be published, and which actually relates to this issue. In other words, in copyright, all Berne Union states, and that's about 168 states, including all the states that we consider civilized and a lot of uncivilized as well, are under an obligation not to protect news of the day under copyright. There are a number of reasons for not doing this. Ideological, systemic, conceptual. Mireille will speak in the next panel on the ideological argument, freedom of expression and information. And this is a very important one, and it also, of course, ties into exceptions and limitations and to journalistic freedoms. But there are also systemic reasons not to grant copyright to news. And one of those, I think, is sometimes overlooked in this discussion. News, and I think you see it also reflected to a degree in current attempts to introduce some sort of protection. News simply does not have sufficient form to generate creative original works to which copyright can actually attach. Items of information, in other words, are too abstract. There are only so many ways to express a news item. Let's give the example of a football match, and this will be a bit painful for our chairman. The example is an Arsenal match. Arsenal Crystal Palace, 1-1. There are only so many ways that you can express that fact. I just expressed it in one way. Here's another way. Arsenal 1, Crystal Palace 1. And then there's a third possibility, although I'm not sure that's even correct English. Crystal Palace draws at Arsenal, or draw, perhaps, at Arsenal 1-1. And that's about it. Choosing between one of these only handful of possible expressions is not a creative choice that can or even should be rewarded by copyright. And a related problem, directly related to that abstractness of news, of facts generally, by the way, I wrote a whole dissertation about this, so that explains some of this philosophical music. A related problem is, imagine that there would be some sort of copyright protection. What could be the scope of that protection if not a full and very undesirable information monopoly? How could we prove infringing misappropriation of these abstract facts that have no shape? How could we prove that we extracted it from this news producer and not from that? Unless in the very unlikely case of a single news monopoly, single source news producer, and those are rare. Of course, there's copyright available for the news industry, and we all know that, for the news expressed in original news articles. And that's what the journalists write, and those are rightly and fully copyrightable. But that's not what the discussion is about today. Introducing a neighboring right for news publishers, as is now contemplated in the consultation that came somewhat as a surprise to me, to be honest, and I think to many observers of the IP scene in Brussels. Introducing a neighboring right for news publishers could perhaps solve this originality issue, but it would never deal with, in a satisfactory way, with the issues of scope and of evidence that are attached to that. The best I could imagine for this new neighboring right to be able to do would be a right enforceable against wholesale piracy, just like the existing phonogram right that clearly has inspired it, but it would not solve the problem. And I think that was already mentioned by many speakers here. That is at the heart of our discussion. Unauthorized news aggregation, as was mentioned, and I think I should repeat that present laws on neighboring rights do not provide such protection against unauthorized news aggregation. So why would transforming the existing phonographic right into a publisher's right do the trick? It's difficult to imagine unless it would be totally recrafted. In fact, the only right presently in existence that does somewhat protect against aggregation, and Dirk Visser already mentioned that, is the EU's sui generis database right. It is now rather downplayed in this discussion, but I remember vividly that one of the reasons why we introduced a database right in the 1990s, and it was controversial then, it's become much more controversial today, but it was already then, was to protect news publishers compiling news data. It was one of the reasons. Reuters was lobbying for it, I remember. Okay, that's old stuff. In fact, this whole idea of a neighboring right is a very old one. It reminds me of many older discussions held at the Dutch Vereniging for Auteursrecht in the 1980s about introducing an uitgeversrecht in the Netherlands. And I'm sure we've had similar discussions in many other member states. I remember Willem Grosheide, Professor Willem Grosheide, and my colleague from Utrecht, advocating in favor of it, and others. There was a whole committee dressed up at the Dutch Copyright Committee. And there was some arguments. But it never led to anything, probably because publishers in the end concluded that they were already sufficiently protected against third parties on the basis of copyrights transferred from their authors. And that, of course, is the same even today. So again, the question arises, why? If we look at the arguments, the very limited number of arguments presented in the consultation, one reason for introducing a neighboring right for publishers would be the analogy with the phonogram producers and the broadcasters and the film producers. They have it. Why don't we give it to the publishers? The equality argument, I think it was mentioned by Richard in the very first session. Sort of the why not argument. If they have it, why not give it to the publishers? I can imagine, if I were a publisher, I would argue along the same line. And I do recognize, like the previous speaker, all the troubles and problems that that the newspaper publishers are currently facing. And they are enormous. And they are a source of concern to everyone. But the why not argument somehow doesn't really convince me. I think before arguing along the why not line, I think we should first look at the why. What would a neighboring right really bring to this industry that would be in any way useful to them? As I said earlier, and many speakers before me, probably not what you would really want, a right to either prevent or prohibit or make licensable aggregation vis-a-vis news aggregators such as particularly Google. The Spanish and the German examples are, I think, rather clear. It's not going to work. All you would have in the end, if we would seriously introduce this neighboring right, would create yet another layer of rights on top of an already well-stacked sandwich of rights, many of which simply have little or no role to play, some of which actually make life in the digital realm even more miserable than it is already today. And that was also mentioned earlier, is reprobel then perhaps a good reason to introduce such a neighboring right? Reprobel, of course, has nothing to do with news. It is a totally unrelated discussion, I think, but it definitely plays a role at the political level, and it is probably not by accident that this consultation is underway now, only a few months after the European Court's decision in the case of HP versus Reprobel. And for those not in the know, I'm sure you all know the story, but according to this European decision, the reprography right levies that exist in Germany and in many other countries in Europe, most other countries in Europe, belong to the authors and not for 50% to the publishers. That's roughly what Reprobel says. I know this is very unnuanced, but this is roughly what is being said. And this is now under repair, clearly, by way of this consultation. Is that a good idea? Is it a good idea to introduce a neighboring right simply to override Reprobel? I can't imagine that is we do not introduce new intellectual property rights simply because the reprography levies are now flowing to the authors in, and still partly to the publishers, I must add, even in Germany after this decision. Not that cannot be a good argument. For one, reprography is an almost dead technology. We're talking about photocopying here. That was an issue indeed in the past, but it is an issue that is becoming gradually extinct. Yes, there are still millions of euros being made, but this is a rapidly decreasing income stream. This cannot be the reason for introducing a neighboring right. On balance, and this is to pacify the chair, I'm almost there. On balance, I'm afraid, and I have to agree here again with my neighbor on the right side, I'm afraid law is not going to help us very much here, at least not intellectual property law. Again, realizing fully the crisis in which news production, news publishing finds itself in, and it is very serious, and I know this industry very well too. It is a very serious industry. I don't think intellectual property is going to help us out of this crisis. I really think we should not even waste our energy thinking along those lines. It is a common reflex. Look at IP law. It's always IP law that is at fault here. But I don't think IP law in any imaginable world is going to help us out of this conundrum. Other business models surely are. That's not my department, of course. I am not competent here, but I would obviously look at that. Subsidies, always interesting. I'm from the Netherlands. We love subsidies. I'm all in favor of that. Rerouting money that now goes to public broadcasters to the press, I'm all in favor of that. More taxing Google and having them pay their taxes in the countries where they're really making money. Yes, please. But I don't think IP is going to work. And again, the music industry is indeed a very good example. The music industry, too, looked at intellectual property, but the solution did not come from there.
Thank you. Mario.
Thank you very much, and thank you for including me in this discussion as a non-expert. Not in copyright, I have some experience in dealing with the news media, but I promise to those of you representing them, I will not hold it against you in this discussion. I was looking on Twitter, and I couldn't help but notice that today is International Day of Books and Copyright. Did you know this? I thought maybe this event was organized as a celebration, but at least it made me smile because, I think we should really look more broadly than just the means like books, but maybe access to content, access to information, and perhaps a broader perspective could help inform us, at least on the political side, too, about what is wisdom, and I tend to agree with Professor Hugenholtz here. But let me share with you some observations from my perspective as a member of European Parliament who has worked to reform copyright to advance the digital single market, but who looks at the role of government really from the primary question of what problem are we trying to solve, what goals are we trying to advance, and certainly not informed by favoring one industry or one sector over another. I simply don't think it's the role of government and policymakers to protect one over the other. In fact, I think we need to help foster innovation and focus primarily on preserving principles like fair competition, the respect for fundamental rights, such as freedom of expression and also access to information, and we should help innovation flourish. So the context in which the whole discussion about access to information online, copyright, the future of news, but also more broadly takes place now is very much related to the development of a digital single market in Europe. There is at least a promise of a single market, but even there, a lot still has to be changed in order to harmonize rules and to create a more predictable smooth regulatory environment for anyone, frankly, to navigate, whether it's the citizen that wants to access information, whether it is the startup that wants to roll out a new product, or whether it's the big company that seeks to provide its services in Europe. And the discussion about copyright has really been quite paralyzed and stagnated for a very long time. It's become very sensitive, even though there are those who hope for and push for radical change. Oftentimes these are startups that are extremely frustrated by the fragmented regulatory landscape, which hinders them from bringing a new movie streaming service from Sweden to consumers in Spain, for example. But there are also those who want absolutely no change at all. And I agree that there has perhaps been too much focus on copyright law and too little consideration of the bigger picture. And we see this very much in the way in which the movie and music industry too have sought to use copyright enforcement and higher punishment as a solution for the threat that they experienced from technological developments. And I think some of the publishers, at least, are going down the same route, pushing for very harsh measures, claiming very high values lost, economic values lost, even though I think we could also argue the reverse. Generally speaking, it is easier to stop change in policies than to pave the way in terms of where new policies should go. So I think that in the effective landscape that we operate, incumbents have an advantage because it's much easier for them to block proposals. They've already built networks of access to decision makers, et cetera, et cetera. And so I think we've seen this in the discussions about copyright reform taking place as well. But while this whole struggle about, you know, whether to have a revolution or an evolution, whether to have drastic or incremental changes going on, technological developments continue. And many of them actually facilitate workarounds, the very laws that people are still discussing. So, for example, the fact that so many people are now using virtual private networks to access information in different EU member states is testimony to that. And I honestly think that these people don't feel like they're engaging in illegitimate or criminal activity. And if you look at access to content and who should pay for it, I always find it very interesting that as a Dutch taxpayer, I cannot look at the evening news that is being streamed when I'm in Belgium, because I too have paid for this. So it's not only about whether or not consumers internet users are paying journalists or media companies enough. It's also, I think, an experience of consumers who feel like they've paid for content, whether it's a commercial platform like Netflix or public broadcasting like NOS News, that they simply cannot access once they cross a border. A border that, at least in the promise of what the EU should mean, should have no impact on this access to content. So the questions about whether the laws are still legitimate, whether they are creating a fair deal for all stakeholders, or whether they're functioning in times of technological developments, I think are very much an integral part of this discussion. Having said that, I do think it is absolutely essential that in this rapidly changing environment, we very much look at the public interest and the way in which the open character of our societies can be preserved. And I do think, responding briefly to the first speaker, that there has been some very important research into, you know, the impact of the use of search engines has on access to information, on creating a tunnel vision. Books like The Black Box Society by Frank Pasquale, I think, are very interesting in this context. So I do believe that this is something policymakers should also very much be aware of. The challenges of journalism are, I think, well known. The question is, can this be solved through copyright law? And I believe we need a much broader discussion for that. I think I could learn more from you today about this question of, you know, what is news, what is investigative journalism, you know, what is a fact that anyone could find, what is a scoop that perhaps leads to expectation of more recognition, but also the reverse, in what way, and I don't know if there's journalists in the room as well, but in what way can journalists through social media and the global internet develop brands in a way that they never could before, which then increases the value of the information that they have to offer, and perhaps makes them more attractive for sources to contact. So I think there's a whole different kind of dynamic that works many different directions that should be explored. And I think that if we look at the need for having pluralist, free, diverse media, we need to look at both funding independent media or creating a space for independent media that is not subject to the ebbs and flows of the free market, but that really has a standalone position as part of open societies. But we must also look at facilitating innovation. I think these are both important. Now, looking at what is happening on the European level, it's been briefly mentioned already, but it's very interesting to see that there are two members of the European Commission primarily responsible for the policies in this space. One, Commissioner Ansip, very much leaning towards embracing the opportunities of technological development, and the other, Commissioner Oettinger, very close to the publishers, particularly in Germany. And so what you see is not only that their weighed views of what the new European digital single market should look like are reflected in the proposals that are put forward, but they also take on board the existing differences between 28 member states as well as different sectors. And so, unfortunately, what you often see is that it becomes the lowest common denominator that's presented at the beginning. It is hardly ever very ambitious, the proposals that we see, and the little space that might be there often gets sort of pushed back by the different stakeholders that then get involved in the discussion. So I think we will continue to see a lack of meaningful change in the laws reflected, and both the market and technological developments kind of catching up, as well as the courts being important spaces for these fights between different interests to be fought out. And I say this without any pride. I wish we could have better European laws sort of embracing the changes that we see and safeguarding the principles that we believe in, but I want to be open about the practice that I see day in, day out. So maybe I'll just try to conclude here and hope that today we can also talk a little bit about how innovations in the market of news media can inform us as policymakers. I don't think we should only be pessimistic. I see a lot of interesting initiatives coming from the Netherlands, such as Blendl, for example, where, contrary to the analogy that more access to more media should bring down the price, I believe I'm paying more per article than I would if I would weigh the size of one article against buying the entire publication. So this notion that there are new models to both create more interesting access to content for consumers and remunerate the publishers and the journalists, I think are certainly worth exploring. Let me just end there, and I look forward to the discussion.
Okay, thank you very much. We have just about 35 minutes for discussion, so plenty of time. Do we have any questions for... Okay, so we have one at the back.
First, I'd like to thank the organization, IViR and CIPIL, for this wonderful day, because as Bernd himself, unfortunately, said during the lunch, but he was absolutely right, it's the moment to do this, and it's unbelievable what kind of people you brought together today, and I'm really fascinated at hearing all which is said. Well, this being said, suppose we would think about an intellectual property right for news publishers. I have three short observations. In the first place, I think that news publishers is something which is quite different from a neighboring right for publishers in general. It is somewhere on the border between unfair competition and intellectual property, and it would be right to keep an eye on that. And the second remark is, even when you're thinking about an intellectual property right, you could still look for unorthodox ways to frame it. For example, what would be the duration of such a right? And there I would say that it is not excluded that the news publishers would be very much helped by an exclusive right of a duration of 24 or 36 hours, which would make the weight such an exclusive right places on the freedom of information much lighter. Because as Egbert Dommering, I think, once said, the news of today, tomorrow is history. And well, still very important from an informational point of view. And then a third very short remark, and even more controversial. What about a moral right for the news publishers? I'm sure everyone is shocked. I would be in favor of a very strong moral right of a duration of about a week, and more specifically about a paternity right, a right to be mentioned as the source. And I would make it strong because I would make it unwaverable. Why? Because I think there is a particular interest from society to know the source of a good, reliable, and innovative news. And if you maintain that right for a week or for 10 days, it wouldn't be a problem either. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Michael Gruberg, University of Bayreuth. I have a question for Bernt Hugenholtz. And I think we partly agree that this inquiry of the Commission is due to the fact of the decision in the Reprobel case. However, I think the Reprobel case dealt only with reprography copyright levy. But let's think about other cases like the Technische Universität Darmstadt case, where it really, where we really go into what can universities, libraries, archives do. And then we have exceptions and limitations to the making available right, and that's actually quite important. So if what I think is now on the political side of the table, particularly with the recent developments in Germany, that there will be a greater push for publishers in general to pursue such an ancillary right. And I think we as copyright lawyers, we should open possible alternatives. And one alternative is, well, let's open and rephrase the InfoSoc directive here and let's make an amendment, that's a possible alternative, to that publishers are entitled in revenue sharing with the copyright levies and so on. And then that would all be off the table. And I think we really should ventilate that idea, because that would be a much better solution for this problem than creating an ancillary right for publishers in general.
First one as well.
I can speak on any topic. But yes, I'd like to respond to both. First to Michael, I totally agree we would take off the pressure a bit of this idea of a new neighboring right for publishers if we would create that rule in the InfoSoc directive. It's probably a much easier politically speaking approach. The question does arise, what kind of rule would that be? And wouldn't that introduce a neighboring right in the InfoSoc directive? Because what would the basis be for the publishers to get that 50%? But okay, that's the fine print. I agree with you, having the choice between the two, I would prefer your model. Back to Anton Quaadvlieg. You proposed various things. I would like to react to the Well, you said you made a very good observation, and I think we all agree on that. There is the arguments for some sort of neighboring right for the news industry is a very different one from the argument for having a general neighboring right for publishers. And by mixing the two into one initiative, I think we're confusing arguments. The news industry needs different things here. And interestingly, again, we have brilliant historic parallels here. There have been in the past many attempts at the international level, particularly, to introduce some sort of specific protection for the news industry, particularly in the form of news bureaus, news agencies like Reuters and AP in the past. And many of those proposals were about very short-term protection schemes of 24-hour or 48 hours, in line with the case described by in the previous panel by Chris, the hot news that gave us the hot news case, the stealing of telegraph of news telegraphs. A very short period of protection would probably be sufficient. That's totally different from what neighboring rights generally has on offer. There, a term of 20 years is sort of the minimum, and it's moving towards 50 or even 70 years. So we're talking about very different kind of rights and needs. There are actually several countries, I've been studying this, in the world that have such unfair competition law-based, very short-term protections for news producers. I don't think these are ever enforced in the digital realm, but we have them, and they are, yeah, certainly an interesting model to look at. They're not neighboring rights, they are specific rules of unfair competition.
Maybe just one additional comment on this notion of exceptions, which is a very lively one, where I think oftentimes the public interest gets squeezed by those who seek further reaching realization of their rights. So I think one thing to keep in mind is that in the interest of harmonization, which I do believe is very much needed, and then we can argue further about, you know, what kind of laws, but that also the exceptions are harmonized, because frankly, while on the one hand, open education and international access to information in the public interest are becoming more and more relevant and simply more easily accessible, the exceptions are still very fragmented and leads to all kinds of problems with access to culture, scientific research, etc. So we have to think about the full picture when we look at what we should organize EU-wide, and exceptions hadn't been mentioned, but I think are very crucial.
I wanted to add something in response to Anton's question, just to reiterate really what Bernt said, but to add one further comment in relation to his moral right for news publishers. It is the case that the exception for quotation under the Berne Convention under Article 10.1 requires attribution of the source, and that derives from the previous version of the Berne Convention, where the exception was directed specifically at news reports. And so effectively, by way of an exception, newspapers do have a moral right of attribution. I don't know how strong it is, but it's there.
With the neighboring right of the broadcaster. First of all, of course, the funny thing is, why did we get that right in the first place? And most people who were involved in getting it here in the 1960s are dead. But I have been told that the only reason why this right came about was to give them something where they would be the people had to pay for the other new neighboring rights. So it was the performing artists who got their own right, and obviously the phonogram producers got that right because they were the strong lobbyists at the time. And especially the public broadcasters at the time were very much against it, especially in the Netherlands as late as the 1990s were against it. And only when they were convinced that it was absolutely sure that the Olympic Games would come to Amsterdam in 1992 and that it was necessary for them to have their own neighboring right at the time, were they convinced that it was a good idea. So it was a funny reason why we got the neighboring right for the broadcasters in the first place. Another interesting thing is that the neighboring right of the broadcasters does not bring them very much. It brings them a little bit of a share of in the private copying levy, and it gives them a right to take action against rebroadcasting, retransmission, which is always the live rebroadcasting. So it is the signal piracy, actually. It's a very short term of protection. It is about a 10-second protection. It's not even 24 hours. It's only against the live rebroadcasting that it's actually used in some cases. And in fact, it's only now the only right they actually need recently, and which they do not have in all countries, became apparent in the Seymour case. Because in the Seymour case, it was about hyperlinking to illegal peer-to-peer live broadcasts of sports games. And there it turns out that that's actually not harmonized at the European level. And that the Swedes, I think it was the Swedes in the Seymour case, do have a separate neighboring right to protect broadcasters against signal piracy through peer-to-peer. So in effect, that does work, that does serve a purpose, and that might give us another reason to come up with a very limited parallel for a very short term of protection. I'm not saying it's a good idea, I'm just drawing the parallel that in essence, the neighboring right of the broadcasting company is very limited time as well. And to that extent, it might work. I still favor the proposal by Michael that we should simply have a rule that we should solve reprobail and leave all the rest to the marketplace. If you want to do something, you can draw the parallel with the broadcasting, which remains interesting.
I thought you were going to propose to give a neighboring right to Google in parallel. But if we...
Additional discussion. They tried, of course, to give the broadcasting right to websites. I think it was in the late 1990s, it was discussion at the WIPO level. Nobody.
That discussion is not over yet.
It's incredible.
No.
Anything would be protected.
That's an endless dossier in Geneva. Yeah.
So, I mean, one of the things about them proposing a new neighbouring right is that people who know something about what neighbouring rights contain know that they all differ. So saying, having a consultation about a new neighbouring right for publishers just doesn't tell you anything about what the content of the right that's being proposed is. And how can you possibly respond to a consultation when you don't know what the content of the right that's
so
being proposed is?
So that goes back to Michael's proposal.
Maybe they're hoping you'll come up with a solution in the consultation, but I mean...
thanks, Mina van Eekhout. I've gotten lots. Just one remark, I guess that's about what Anton proposed, that there should be a right of attribution for news publishers, or publishers more generally. In the context, I think, of the news aggregation services, the mentioning of the source is not a problem, as far as I know. I mean, it's obvious where they're linking to, so that's a solution in search of a non-problem, I guess. but I was also thinking, when it comes to the question, if you would introduce some sort of right with a very short time span, how's that going to be enforced? And I immediately started thinking, time zones, internet, I'm not sure that, I don't know, but maybe somebody with a more technical background can explain how that would be enforceable. But my main questions were two. One was to you, Marietje Schaake, because you were involved with the letter by a number of MEPs basically saying to the Commission, please, will you not go forward with talk about this ancillary right? Do you get any feedback from the Commission on that right? So on that letter, or I'm not sure whether they're... You hear things, well, I'm sure you hear a lot of things, but how things operate at the European Parliament in terms of feedback loops between the Commission and members of Parliament. I just was very curious what kind of response, if any, you got. And then the second question is to Bertin Martens. You talked about how it's common in many industries that you see the superstar effect and the long tail and the squeeze in the middle. And today we focus on news publishers, and everybody agrees that they're in dire straits. Is the same true across other areas of publishing? I mean, book publishing, general publishing. We've heard this morning from STM, who are in a totally different dynamic because they rely to a large degree on publicly funded content, basically. Because if we talk about a publisher's rights, I'm still struggling to understand why. I can see the position news industry are in. I'm not in favor of a neighboring right for a lot of reasons, but I have even more trouble conceiving of why other publishers would need one. Is there any economic basis for it?
So, sorry for looking at my phone, but I just looked up the answer, which we got. But it basically refers to the consultation and says that after that, decisions will be made. So usually what happens, it's not unlike many other answers that we usually get, they refer to process while we ask about substance. And so just pushing, kicking the can down the road a bit still. But I think what you see reflected here also is really a tension within the European Commission on where to go. Enormous pressure from the publishing industry to protect them. And also pressure from others to ensure that there is a better functioning, harmonized European copyright suited for the digital age, which is a much broader goal than just asking how our news companies, I don't even want to talk about newspapers much anymore, but how are they going to survive, which is a very legitimate discussion, but I agree that the risk really is to see a nail because all you have is a hammer kind of thing. Just kind of not look broad enough at the problems, like you said, or the non-problems that should be solved, and instead delaying progress in a legal framework, which could also, in the ultimate case, lead to a complete lack of trust and legitimacy experienced with regard to some of these laws, while technological developments simply allow for circumvention. And then nobody wins, if you ask me, because then it just becomes kind of a de facto establishment of norms.
Yes, to answer your question on this squeeze and the distribution, this is indeed a phenomenon that we observe generally all across the internet and all across sectors. The reason why this happens is very simple to understand. What you get with the internet is, on the supply side, all of a sudden you get a choice between millions of newspaper articles, goods, books, films, music, whatever. So there's an enormous choice, an enormous variety. On the other hand, you have consumers who look for what they want to find, and they use search engines or aggregators or whatever channels to find what they're looking for. You have two types of consumers, two types of search, let's say. You have consumers who say, give me the hot news of the day. And they automatically are led to the superstars. What are the hot articles for today? What are the subjects that are really on today? And you have consumers who say, I'm interested in what happened on that particular topic or in a very specific issue, and they are the long-tailed searchers. There are not many of those, but since there are millions of articles, they will find an article on that. Since consumers are split between these two types of search behavior, what is left out is this big middle ground of things that are of some interest, somebody, but do not attract really either the attention of one group or the other. And so we see that in music, we see that in film, we see that, I haven't seen any research that has studied this in newspaper articles yet, but I'm sure if somebody would do it, we'll probably find a very similar phenomenon. What stops this movement from happening is compartmentalization or segmentation of the market. So if people are used to go to one newspaper or two newspapers and they watch only those every day, you get only the articles that are on that newspaper. And that's why people go to aggregators, because you get an overview of all the newspaper articles anywhere in the world or in your country, in your language, or on your subject. And that's where you go if you're more targeted research. So that is the main advantage of these news aggregators from a consumer perspective.
No, I just wanted to develop this thought a little bit further. And if we look at the interest of access to, pluralist, free, independent media. I think we need to also highlight the reverse effect. I talk to journalists a lot about how news media are struggling with new technology and also the business models that some of the search engines and ad-based services are using. And it is also informing editorial decisions to a huge extent. So there's a constant analysis of which articles are clicked on. Gossip articles are much more often clicked on than, let's say, investigative journalism pieces. So, I mean, I think we need to have a more philosophical discussion about the interplay between quality journalism, access to multiple sources of information, avoiding sort of tunnel vision, et cetera, and how new business models and new technologies are influencing both sides. I think it would be too simple of a representation to suggest that there are sort of, you know, publishers and journalists on one side standing by and looking at how this wave of technology is washing over them. There are constantly business-driven decisions and editorial decisions being made also that are informed by these new business models as well.
Martin Senfleben, Free University, Amsterdam. Well, actually, thank you so much for all the insights we received today. I think it's very clear now which kind of related right we need. Actually, the problem with the present approach is that it all focuses on copyright, and copyright focuses on the what I would call the individual information unit. So one individual work in the sense of one individual article or one individual quotation, one individual snippet. This is wrong because people are not longer willing to pay for this individual snippet. We have heard that this is substitutable. There are lots of bloggers, Twitters, and so on out there. So nobody will pay for this. But obviously, people are willing to pay a lot for content aggregation. This is why the Googles of this world have no difficulty making lots of money. So it is quite clear that publishers, if they want to develop sustainable business models, must simply behave much more like aggregators and much less like individual information unit producers. This is where the future lies, I think. I mean, I'm not an economist myself, but listening to what has been said today, this, I think, transpires quite clearly from the whole debate. So if you think about some help for publishers, and I'm not sure whether this should be a related right, whether this should have something to do with intellectual property, but if you also think about something in terms of subsidies or something, I think the question is, how can you help the publishing sector, and perhaps in particular the news publishing sector in Europe, to create premium aggregation websites that are so attractive that people do not simply go to the offers of the general search engines or news websites, but go to these premium aggregation sites that publishers create themselves? And why should they have difficulty? I mean, if it is true what publishers themselves have said this morning, they know better about their content, they are closer to their community, they simply know all the things nobody else knows about the content. They even know more than the academic community, for example. So Elsevier knows more about the academic community than the academic community itself. So let them show that they can create these premium services, and I'm sure this would also have an added value for consumers and information welfare in total. So this should be the question, and not so much this old-fashioned focus on an individual work or snippet or whatever, which will never be solved and which, it seems, will not work anyway. So my question would be, how do we do this?
We're going to take a number of points and questions. So do you want to pass it to Tarlac and we'll...
Yeah. Thank you all for the interesting presentations. Tara McGonigal from IViR. I'm not a copyright expert, and at the risk of being labeled a mischief maker, I was hoping to ask a question about the definition of the news. I was wondering whether in relevant debates there's a consensus about at least the approximate meaning of news, or is there, are there any definitional aspects that are proving controversial or relevant from the point of view of whether a new law would help? Thank you.
I can agree with a lot of things that were said, especially with Bernd's argument that law itself wouldn't help much to increase to make the world better for press publishing in the future. I don't think so. That there is the angle of the solution which we can come up with. And I do also think that we in our expert filter bubble here all agree on that more or less, and that there must be something else to come up with. The problem that I see, although, is that in the Brussels filter bubble, there are a lot of arguments exchanged that definitely not and deliberately not distinguish between all these different aspects, like they don't go into the question whether reprobel is fair or not, and whether we need or whether there is a connection between a neighboring right and this value gap, if it is one for the press publishers, and so on and so on. It's not a discussion like that on the political level. The discussion is framed totally different. And if you go to a conference and listen to Commissioner Oettinger and people like that, you will get the impression, and if you are not a very informed observer of this discussion and an expert in these things, you will get the impression that A, we need a neighboring right for publishers because that is essential for media pluralism in the digital world, right? You won't hear an argument that underlines that or emphasizes that or proves that even, but it sounds reasonable, right? And everybody says, well, yes, journalism is extremely important, quality journalism even more, right? So you say you need a neighboring right for that, okay, yeah, let's do that. Why could anybody oppose that? So that's exactly the danger that turned out to be the problem in the German discussion, and in Spain there was no discussion, so I don't know about that, obviously, right? But in Germany it was like all the time people were saying this or that. I know it's complex, there is no connection between the income of news aggregators and news publishers, because and so on and so on. We all know that, but Commissioner Oettinger does not, and he prefers not to know and not wanting to know, right? And that's, I think that is exactly what we have to do to make these distinctions, to go into the details and say, well, reprobel is not a problem with a neighboring right or not a neighboring right, it's a problem of a simple rule that could be come up with in the by changing the InfoSoc directive. By the way, the German Ministry of Justice has made such a proposal some weeks, a week, I think, after reprobel was published, officially to Commissioner Oettinger how to solve this. And this has nothing to do with neighboring rights or ancillary rights. It just says publishers can be entitled to a share, and if they are, whether they are, that is the decision of the national member states.
Yeah, I'd just like to ask a question about the political wrappers that go around the products that have been discussed at the event today. Very confusing. My question is this. The outer wrapper, let's just stay with that one, the outer wrapper under which all of the politics and policy proposals are made is that of the digital single market. Can any of the panel make any connection between what is going on and the pursuit of a digital single market?
So we've got Andrew and then the person behind Andrew. And sorry, I've disallowed you just because we're running out of time.
Can I just say one thing in defense of publishers? I work for The Guardian, and yeah. The idea that kind of an individual blogger could have done the Panama Papers or Snowden is ridiculous. An organization like The Guardian or The Times that did the Lance Armstrong story, it requires teams of journalists and teams of lawyers to go through a story line by line. So I think this idea that kind of bloggers on their own can survive and kind of produce public interest journalism is kind of fantasy.
I think I just wanted to ask the panel and highlight the fact that creating a connection between looser copyright laws and innovation is utterly ridiculous. I don't see any evidence, and I don't think any of you can produce any evidence, that relaxing copyright law creates innovation. All it does is encourage people to sit in bedrooms and play with taking other people's content and trying to resell it. That's not innovation. And I think we should be clear in our heads about that.
My name is Jonas Holton, student of computer science and engineering, and I just wanted to add a comment to two earlier speakers regarding the supposed 24-36 hour right of the publishers and how that could be enforced. And I was thinking along the same lines as an earlier speaker, that on the internet it's very hard to prove when something was published, because it's very easy to forge something. So, I mean, yes, you could probably implement this as a law, but you would have extreme difficulties enforcing it.
I choose to answer to Martin. Indeed, the world would look very different if newspapers could get together and create their own platform on which they would publish their content and try to draw all the consumers together so that consumers could roam around and pick articles from different newspapers on the same platform. However, there's a collective action problem there. How do you get hundreds of newspapers together to work together? So people have tried this in different ways, and look at the Huffington Post, for instance, as an example, started from scratch, where not professional journalists, but everybody else could write their own piece and bit. There was some sort of editing and curation at the editorial level, but it turned out into a rather successful business model in the end. And these copies of the Huffington business model have been tried in several places, several countries, some successfully, some not, but did not involve, unfortunately, the newspaper industries or the newspapers directly. So they were started from scratch. I think what Facebook is trying to do nowadays is, again, trying to bring the newspapers together on its own platform, of course, with some sort of negotiation conditions. And hope that it works. So this is an alternative, I think, to the Google News or Apple News approach, where you simply aggregate existing things without even asking the newspaper publishers whether they agree. We'll see in the future how that works out, whether that is more successful. I think it has lots of chances, but it requires more collaboration and negotiation between the newspaper publishers and Facebook in this case. Yeah.
I chose to respond to myself. Also to speak to what Till said earlier, that the discussions in Brussels indeed are oversimplifications, obviously. And I think this is something for us. This should very much be of concern to the newspaper industry, well represented here. Their issues are clearly being hijacked by the general publishers, and eventually the result is predictable. This general neighboring right will not happen, and then party over. I would be very concerned to be sitting on a panel next to an STM publisher if I were you. These would be the beneficiaries of this very same neighboring right that would help you nothing and would probably help a lot of other publishers a lot more. And I think politically that would be a very bad idea for everyone. Clearly, let's take the example of the STM publisher. I'm not sure he's still in the room. What?
He had to fly back,
sure. Okay, then I will attack him vehemently. Imagine this, a neighboring right for scientific publishers who in the last 20 years have outsourced almost everything, all the editing, all the correction, everything that they used to invest in for making good books. It's not being done by us, authors, scientific authors. The printing is outsourced, the distribution is outsourced, or has become digital. There is hardly any investment worth a Leistungsschutzrecht compared to the old days, when even then the arguments were fairly weak. Today, they are almost non-existent. This is not something that applies to the news industry, I should say, but it does to many other publishers. The argument for a general neighboring right, or a general neighboring right for publishers, is exceptionally weak. And if you join forces with them, I think this is the end of the story. So I would say, and agree with many others here, that if we want to do something for the news industry, it should be something for the news industry and not for publishers generally.
Okay, thank you. I mean, first of all, should it not have been clear, I think we all have to make sure that there is enough quality journalism to apply the needed check on power, whether it's in the hands of elected officials or the private sector or whoever else. But the question is, how do you get there? And I think it merits a broader discussion. And in political discussions, I'm afraid it will always be the case that there are simplified frames, false arguments, et cetera, et cetera. And so it's one up to you to bring scientific research to the discussion and to make sure that you're at least competing with bringing information to decision makers. But it's nothing new. I mean, in the whole discussion about copyright for so long, we've heard major movie and music industries claiming to seek to protect the arts from the internet, right? And I think that was also a terrible simplification, not in the least because the creators are often not the ones who get fairly remunerated by those very same industries that are claiming to speak on their behalf. So this is nothing new. But it's important to be aware of how it goes, and that, unfortunately, very complex discussions often get simplified. Now, on what does it all have to do with the digital single market? Why does it matter? Why is it relevant for innovation, et cetera, et cetera? One of the opportunities that we're trying to create by removing unnecessary barriers is that of scale. So that in a more predictable and harmonized regulatory landscape, an audience and a creator, whether it's a journalist and a reader or a musician and a listener or whatever, can more easily connect with the help of technologies. And so in order for all kinds of business models to be competitive also globally and for startups to scale, et cetera, this relatively fast rollout to a large audience helps. And that is what we're trying to do. And it is through harmonizing laws where they may still be chopped in 28 different pieces, which is the case for copyright law. And this is just like a structural observation, regardless of whether you think there should be neighboring rights or not, there should be more rights or fewer rights, but factually speaking, there are 28 different copyright systems, 28 different sets of exceptions, and it simply costs a lot of time and money for people to navigate that space. But we also have to work on all kinds of other aspects of the digital single market in order to create an open and predictable environment with fair competition and consideration of internet users or consumers or whatever you want to call it. I've worked a lot on ensuring there's net neutrality. We've sought to abolish excessive roaming charges so that it's easier for people to go across borders and still use the same services. But it also should be addressed through competition law that is applied equally, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a much broader discussion, I think, than just about copyright at all. But in an environment that's more predictable and that it is larger, it would be easier for all kinds of different services, such as the ones that were sketched, like premium services. Now, I don't know if government should even get involved in dictating where the market should go, but if there is such a solution which could help content and audiences get together and benefit from scale through lowering prices, et cetera, that could be an opportunity that flourishes better in a digital single market than in a fragmented market. Oh, we're keeping people from coffee. Okay, I understand. Just one more comment then, I'll close. But the question was, why does the digital single market even help innovation? If I understand correctly, that was another question. Well, or what does copyright reform help innovation?
No, what would the neighboring right have to do with the digital single market? I think that's...
Well, I thought there was a gentleman behind here that asked a question. Well, I think exceptions, for example, are crucial for remixing, just to give you an idea, for access to culture, for digitizing cultural heritage and making it available to the public, not only in Europe, but globally, for scientific cooperation across borders. I think there are actually a lot of ways in which exceptions and more flexible copyright can help innovation, but I understand that's a political discussion.
Okay, thank you to our panelists and to the audience for great questions.